إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد Brothers and sisters in Islam, one of the most beautiful aspects and one of the most profound aspects about marriage is the element of benevolent support through small kindnesses that each spouse extends to one another in all facets of their marital experience. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands both husband and wife to recall or to remember, even as they are transitioning out of the marriage towards divorce, as these gestures of kindness and compassion have merit and should not be dismissed or forgotten about simply because the marriage didn't survive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلَا تَنْسَوُ الْفَضْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and as you are transitioning out of your marriage, لَا تَنْسَوُ الْفَضْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ Do not forget about the kind gestures that you shared between each other. Do not forget about the good times that you had between each other. Don't forget about those experiences, because it is the respect for these experiences or these gestures that give our experience value. For if we throw the baby out with the bathwater, the relationship is over, and you're almost like an enemy to me, you've never done anything good, then that means that our experiences, the gestures, they mean nothing. And an example of this is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is very important for us because we take violations to a whole nother level. When you violate me or you do something I don't like, it's almost as we see you as a complete stranger. And it's dismissive. And it makes the experiences that we have between each other mean nothing. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was on his way to go attack Mecca, it was the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he would keep his moves silent. He wouldn't even disclose where he was going or where he was going or who he was attacking until they were already on the journey on the way. This is smart as a leader because you know that you have hypocrites in your midst. So you don't disclose everything is not for everybody. You don't disclose everything before it's time to give people leverage to sabotage what you're doing. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in another hadith, he told us, "Ista'inu ala hawa'idikum bikitman, fa inna kulli bi ni'matin mahsud." Seek assistance with the success of your affairs by being silent. Because for every person that has a blessing, there is somebody that is going to envy you for it. So sometimes you have to move in silence. And so one of the Sahaba, Hafidh ibn Abi Balta'a, he got wind that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going to attack Mecca. So he wrote a letter to his family disclosing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's moves, which is considered treachery in Islam. Something that would make a person be considered a disbeliever. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Hatib did this. So before the lady who he sent the letter with could reach Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent 2-3 of his Sahaba to go retrieve the letter before it got there. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at the letter, there was Hatib's signature. Also Jibreel came down from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reveal it to him. So he has every right to take issue with Hatib and what he did. However, he wanted to hear Hatib's side of the story. He goes to Hatib and he says, "Ya Hatib, ma hamalaka ala hada? What made you do this? I just want to see if there is some type of logic that I can extract from this." And Hatib, he said, "Oh, Messenger of Allah, I didn't do it because I'm a disbeliever or I love the disbelievers or I was being treacherous or betraying you. I did it because I'm not from Quraysh. And I know that when you and your companions get to Mecca, you're going to take over everything. And I just wanted to give my family a heads up." Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, "Ya Rasulullah, da'ni adrib. Unuk hadha munafiq." He said, "Oh, Messenger of Allah, give me permission to strike the neck of this hypocrite." Umar, in his rage, completely forgot about all of the virtues that Hatib extended to the Muslim community beforehand. Similar to what we do when we get angry with someone, more importantly, within the realm of marriage between husband and wife. How could you get mad at your wife or get mad at your husband and forget all of the good that they have ever extended to you? That anger is misplaced. It is beyond the scope of what we are allowed in our deen. Umar says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ya Rasulullah, let me strike the neck of that hypocrite." Totally wrote him off. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La ya Umar." He said, "No Umar, innahu shahida badran." That man participated in the battle of Badr. I will never forget that. That man risked his life for Islam when the Muslims were only 314 against over 1,000 of the disbelievers. There was a clear disadvantage and the man still risked his life. And I'm not going to let this mistake totally wipe out everything that the man did before him. This is our religion. This is our deen. To be balanced when we deal with violations. And so the legislation of Islam has allocated rights for both husband and wife that covers their emotional, physical, spiritual needs within the framework of their commitment to one another, which allows them to achieve the highest level of human fulfillment within the scope of their worldly and spiritual experience. These rights between husband and wife in Islam are governed by the 5 basic necessities that are outlined in the science of usul al-fiqh. They are known as al-dururiyat al-khams, the five basic necessities that every Muslim is due. All of the legislation that we have in the Quran and the Sunnah revolve around or are governed by these five principles. And that is the preservation of, number one, your deen, hifd al-deen. Number two, hifd al-hayat, preservation of your life. Hifd al-mal, preservation of your wealth. Hifd al-aql, preservation of your intellect. Hifd al-nasab, and the preservation of your lineage. And some scholars add a sixth to that, and as hifd al-irq, and that's the preservation of your honor. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He describes the relationship between husband and wife with many descriptions. These qualities, all of them point towards this benevolent support, which is oftentimes reveals itself in the form of protection, mercy, compassion, and being a covering for one another. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, الرِّجَالُ قَوَّامُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ بِمَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بَعْضُهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ وَبِمَا أَنفَقُوا مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. Allah says that men are the protectors. We usually translate it as protectors and maintainers. But in translating qawama as protectors and maintainers, it oftentimes translates as this feeling of superiority over our wives. But what qawama actually means is riaya, is consideration, with himaya and protection, to guard and protect. That's what it means. And then Allah goes on at the end of the ayah to say that Allah has given the man a status above the woman because he spends from his wealth. Not 50-50, not you do this, I do that. No, I spend from my wealth. That is my responsibility. In the next part of the verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the women in the marriage with the same description. He says, "Fasalihat, qanitat, hafidhatun lilghaybi bima hafidhallah." He says, so the righteous women are qanitat, are obedient, meaning they are willfully compliant with the demands, the reasonable demands of their husband. They are obedient. Righteous women are obedient. Hafidhatun, and they protect and guard in their husband's absence what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would command her to protect. So in both descriptions, you can see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses protection over one another as one of the descriptions that husband and wife are described with within the realm of marriage. There was a beautiful example of this involving one of the daughters of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. This was the older sister of Aisha, Asma bint Abi Bakr. Asma was married to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's cousin, Az-Zubair ibn Awan. And in this incident, Asma, she discloses this protection that as a woman she has over her husband in his absence. Asma, she says, تزوجني الزبير وماله في الأرض من مال ولا مملوك ولا شيء غير ناضج ناضح يعني الجمل وغير فرسه. She said, when الزبير married me, he didn't have anything. He didn't own any land. He didn't have a slave. He didn't own maids or servants. Only thing that he owned at the time that I married him was this camel and his horse. These were the only two things that he had. She said, so I used to tend to his camels and his horse, his camel and his horse. Used to graze them, feed them, give them something to drink. She said, I wasn't good at baking bread, but my neighbor from the Ansar, this woman, she used to bake bread for us. And the women of the Ansar, kana nisa sidqin, they were sincere, honest women. She said, and one day, kuntu anqul an-nawa min ard al-Zubair allati aqta'ahu lil-Zubair an-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said, so one day, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had given Zubair a piece of land. And in that piece of land, Zubair used to grow date palm trees. She said, and this piece of land was about 2 miles from our home. She said, and I used to go to this land and I would carry the date stones on my head from the piece of land to our home. She said, فَجِئْتُ يَوْمًا فَلَقِيَنِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَمَعَهُ نَفَرٌ مِّنَ الْأَنصَارِ. She said, so one day I'm walking from the plot of land carrying these heavy date stones on my head. And I saw the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam along with a group of his companions in the street. She said, when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam noticed me carrying these heavy things on my head, he got off his camel and he told the camel, sit down, so that I could get on the back of the camel. She said, فَاسْتَحْيَيْتُ. She said, but I was too shy. Here's the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with all these men around. I'm too shy. She said, وَذَكَرْتُ غَيْرَةُ الزُّبَيْرِ وَكَانَ أَغْيَرُ النَّاسِ. She said, and I thought about the jealousy of my husband in that moment. And my husband was the most jealous of men. This is a woman being considerate and being overprotective of her husband in his absence. Not that my husband is not around, I can get a little loose, I'll do things in the absence of my husband that I wouldn't do in his presence. No, the same way that I would honor him in his presence is the same way that I would honor him in his absence. These women had integrity. These women had honor. She said, and when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam noticed my shyness, he got on his camel and he kept going. He noticed that I was being reluctant to get on, so he didn't challenge me. He let me go and he went about his way. She said, so when I got home, in the spirit of being transparent, in the spirit of sharing this with my husband, because these are those small deposits that we make into our marriages that helps to build the harmony and trust between us. Sometimes we disclose things to our spouse that we don't have to, but we do it and we're hoping that our spouse sees our sincerity. I didn't have to share this with you, but the fact that I did, I want you to acknowledge that. I'm trying to build something here between us. So she goes home and she says to Zubair, and I saw the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as I was walking, carrying the date stones on my head. He made the camel sit down, but I was too shy to get on. As Zubair says to his wife, she said, Wallahi, lahamduki annawa kana ashaddu alayya min rukubiki ma'ahu. He said, I swear by Allah, oh my dear wife, here's another deposit. They're making exchanges right here in this moment. He said, oh my beloved wife, he said, I swear by Allah, the thought of you carrying date stones on your head for 2 miles to the house is heavier on me than you riding with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I would have much rather you take the ride with him than for you to carry that on your head. And Asma, she said that Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, her father, sent her a maid servant later on. Arsala ilayya Abu Bakr khadimin takfini siyasat al-faras. She said, my father sent me a maid after this, realizing how far the walk was and how much of a burden I was taking on to help my husband out. My father sent me a maid, and this maid, she began to do the work for me, so I didn't have to do it anymore. And it was as if my father had emancipated me, had freed me from slavery. And so when you look at this incident, you can see the gestures of kindness that is extended from both of them. The gestures of mercy and compassion and protection of one another, which becomes the deposits that we make into one another's bank accounts within our marriage, that creates a harmonious relationship that can endure any of life's challenges. The problem with many of us today is that we deny small kindnesses. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَمْنَعُونَ الْمَعُونَ. And you deny small kindnesses. Can you hand me this? Or can you bring me this? Or you're in a store buying something and you think about your spouse. The same way Asma, she said, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam extended her the ride, she said, I thought about the jealousy of my husband in that moment. I can't do it. And just imagine your wife coming home to you, telling you that, you know, I got a ride from a friend, but she had her husband in the car, and I could never dishonor you like that. As a man, you would feel like, man, subhanAllah, she honored me even in my absence. And she didn't even have to tell me this. These are the things that build trust between people in their relationships. These are the things that we remember when we are going through challenges in our marriages, as everybody does.
As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us, وَلَا تَنْسَوُ الْفَضْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ. Do not forget the kind gestures that were extended between you. This is what gives our experiences value, and this is what helps to create harmony in our relationships. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بما جاء فيه من الآيات والذكر الحكيم أقول ما تسمعون أستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المؤمنين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم.
Just please move up, inshallah, as close as you can. Don't worry about sitting in the ranks. We'll straighten the ranks out, inshallah, when it's time for us to pray. Right now, we just need everybody to move in, move up, so that the people coming in can have a place to sit, inshallah.
Alhamdulillah, al-Ali al-Jabbar, ghafir al-dhambi wa qabil al-tawbi shadid al-iqab. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله.
Brothers and sisters in Islam, these constant displays of love and protection and support helps to create the environment of trust, an environment of trust and security that paves the way for personal thriving at its highest level. In another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the relationship between husband and wife as being a covering for one another. This is a very intimate description that represents protection of one's vulnerability, which is one of the most sacred qualities of any relationship, and one which a healthy relationship cannot exist except with it. Being vulnerable means to let your guard down and let the person see the real you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةُ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ إِلَى نِسَائِكُمْ هُنَّ لِبَاسُ لَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لِبَاسُ لَهُنَّ. At the beginning of Islam, when the Muslims were fasting during the month of Ramadan, they only had a small window within which to be intimate with their spouses. And that was between Maghrib and Isha. From the time they broke their fast until Salatul Isha. That was the time that was allotted for the men to be intimate with their women at the beginning of Islam. So if you didn't break your fast and then go home and be intimate with your spouse before Isha came in, then you missed the window. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His mercy, abrogated that initial command by now making it permissible for Muslim men to be intimate with their wives from Salatul Maghrib all the way until the sign of the dawn before it's time for you to begin fasting, before Fajr. So now the window has been expanded out of mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, now it is permissible. أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةُ الصِّيَامِ أَرَّفَثَ إِلَى النِّسَائِكُمْ. Now it is permissible for you to be intimate with your wives during the nights in Ramadan. Your wives are a covering for you, and you are a covering for your wives. That is a very intimate description, especially when you think about what clothes represent. Why do we put on clothes? We put on clothes to cover the parts of our bodies that we don't want the world to see. That's what a covering does. Protects your vulnerability, both literally and figuratively. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Ya bani Adam, قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسَ يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا وَلِبَاسَ التَّقْوَى ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ ذَلِكَ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَذَّكَّرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O children of Adam, indeed we have revealed, we have sent down to you clothes. Clothing. لِيُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ, to cover your awrah, cover the parts of your body you don't want exposed. وَرِيشَ, and for beautification. Two reasons that we put on clothes. One is to cover our bodies, and the other is to look nice. Nothing wrong with looking nice. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no one will enter into Jannah who has a mustard seed of pride in his heart. So one of the Sahaba said, O Messenger of Allah, إِنَّ رَجُلْ مِنَّا يُحِبُّ أَنْ يُكُونُ ثَوْبُهُ حَسَنٌ وَنَعْلُهُ حَسَنٌ. He said, O Messenger of Allah, there's a man from amongst us who he likes his clothes to look nice, and he likes his sandals to look nice. Because people oftentimes associate that with arrogance, or you're arrogant. Just look nice, and you choose not to. Nothing arrogant about that. I choose to take care of myself. I choose to take care of my hygiene. I choose to make sure my clothes are ironed and I come outside to look nice. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing shameful or embarrassing about that. Does it make you worldly because you take care of yourself? We associate righteousness with being a hermit or just coming outside with wrinkled clothes on. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, we saw a guy walking with, you know, his bishq on, he had this overgarment on and his thobe, and he's wrinkled and he's walking with his head down, and Umar walked behind him and smacked him in his neck and he said, "Irfa' ra'sak," lift your head up. He said, humility is in your heart, not in your neck, man. I don't care how you walk or how you look, how you dress, humility is here. Not about how you look. Piety is here. At-taqwa hahuna. The Prophet ﷺ said, taqwa is here. Pointed to his chest three times. So the man said to the Prophet ﷺ, a man likes his clothes to be nice, his shoes to be nice. The Prophet ﷺ said, inna Allaha jameelun wa yuhibbu jamal wa yuhibbu in yara athara ni'mihi ala abdihi. That Allah is beautiful and He loves beauty and He loves to see the traces of His ni'mah on His servants. Traces, not all of it. Traces of His ni'mah on His servants. Nothing wrong with that. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we have indeed sent down upon you clothing to cover your awrah and to adorn yourself and to beautify yourself with. But the clothing of piety is the best form of clothing that you can wear. You go on a trip, you pack your bags, you pack your Gucci, you pack your Louis, you pack this, you pack that. Don't forget to pack your taqwa. Pack your taqwa with you. Libas al-taqwa, dhalika khayr. The clothing of piety and righteousness and God-fearing is the best clothing that you can take with you. This is from the signs of Allah, so that perhaps you may take a reminder. And so, husband and wife being a covering for one another, this is necessary for a healthy relationship. When the Prophet ﷺ first received revelation from Jibreel, Jibreel grabbed him and said to him, "Iqra, read." The Prophet ﷺ said, "Ma ana biqari," I don't know how to read. Grabs him again, lets him go, and he says to him again, "Iqra, read." The Prophet ﷺ said, "Ma ana biqari," I don't know how to read. And then he gave him the first five ayahs from Surah Al-Alaq. "Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Khalaq al-insana min alaq. Iqra wa rabbuka al-akram." The Prophet ﷺ, after leaving out of that experience, he runs home to his wife, Khadija. Husband and wife are what to one another in a relationship? A covering. He runs home to Khadija, and soon as he rushes through the door, he says, what? "Zemmiluni, zemmilu." Cover me, cover me. He's looking for that covering. This is the physical covering. He's shivering, he's scared. Seeing this creature, he looks up into the horizon and he takes up all of the space in the horizon. Never seen anything like this before would be enough to drive any man insane. He runs home to his wife and he has to disclose to her what he saw. That's vulnerability, because you don't know if she's going to accept you or reject you. That's vulnerability. I'm scared to say it because I don't know if you're going to say yes or no. How many brothers, how many sisters in relationships, and you are afraid to let your guard down because you don't know if this person is going to accept you? So you walk around with a mask on the entire time. Afraid to be yourself. Afraid to be who you are and bask in your own individuality. So I have to be something other than what I am because of the fear that people won't accept me. Unfortunately, in our neighborhoods, we're famous for this. Many of our children, many of us, we're very intelligent, very bright human beings, but we get around certain individuals and we have to act ignorant. Because God forbid, I show my intelligence in front of this group of ignorant people and they're going to reject me. And I want to be accepted so bad that I will feign ignorance. I will play ignorant. Until we get old enough to realize that I don't owe anybody anything. I owe me more than I owe anybody else. I don't owe anybody anything. But how many mistakes and how many things that we have to go through before we arrive at that station of enlightenment? And how much of our lives have we wasted trying to be something that we're not. The Prophet ﷺ goes home to Khadija and he says, Zammiluni, Zammiluni, cover me, cover me. That's the physical covering. But now he has to tell his wife what's wrong. He says to Khadija, لَقَدْ خَشِيتُ عَلَى نَفْسِي. I'm afraid that I am losing my mind. I'm afraid that this is a sign that God is humiliating me. He now starts to question himself, simply because he knows that if he discloses what he saw, the vast majority of people won't be able to accept it. And Khadija, in that moment, she provided him with the emotional covering that he needed. She says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that moment, "Kalla, abshir, wallahi la yukhzika Allahu abadan." She said, "No, glad tidings. Allah would never humiliate somebody like you." She said, "Wallahi, innaka latasilu ar-rahim. You keep family ties. Wa tasdiqu al-hadith, and you are honest and truthful. Wa tahmilu al-kala." And you support people who are going through difficult times, orphans, and people who don't have fathers. How many boys have the Prophet ﷺ taken into his home? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Ali ibn Abi Talib. These were young men that were raised, Usama ibn Zayd, Zayd ibn Haritha. These were men that were raised in the house of the Prophet ﷺ. Took them in. وَتُطْرِقُ الضَّيْفِ. And you take care of your guests. وَتُعِينُ عَلَى النَّوَائِبِ الْحَقِّ. And you support the truth no matter where it is. This was the emotional covering that the Prophet ﷺ needed in that moment. Giving life to the ayat that Allah says that the women are a covering for their husbands. And it was because of this, the Prophet ﷺ was able to stand up on his two feet and embrace his journey head on. Because of the wise words of his wife, being that covering for him. And for some of us, especially our women, can you imagine how many things your husband hasn't disclosed to you? Because you haven't shown that you are that covering for him? Or vice versa for the men, can you imagine how many doors you have not unlocked in your relationship with your spouse because your wife doesn't feel comfortable with disclosing that to you? So we gotta constantly walk around with masks on, guards up all the time, because we haven't understood this. And this was a gesture that the Prophet ﷺ would later on extend to Khadija, even after she was gone. Khadija covered the Prophet ﷺ when he needed that covering. And the Prophet ﷺ returned the favor later on when Khadija wasn't even alive. Radiallahu anha. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, "I have never been more jealous of any woman that I have never met like my jealousy about Khadija." She said that the Prophet ﷺ always mentioned Khadija, كَأَنَّهُ لَيْسَ فِي الدُّنْيَا إِمْرَأَةٌ إِلَّا Khadija. He used to mention Khadija so much as if there was no other woman in the world other than Khadija. She said he mentioned her one day and it ignited my jealousy and I couldn't control myself. And I said to him, "Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, why do you keep remembering this old woman who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has replaced her with somebody better, me? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned to Aisha and he said, "Kaifa qulti?" What did you just say? He said, "Wallahi ma abdalani Allahu khayrun minha." He said, "Wallahi, Allah didn't replace her with somebody that is better. إِنَّهَا آمَنَتْ بِي إِذْ كَفَرَ بِي النَّاسِ. She believed in me when everybody else disbelieved in me. This woman extended to me things that nobody has ever extended to me. She believed in me when nobody else believed in me." Going back to the covering, he never forgot. Men never forget. People never forget the kind gestures that were extended to them. We remember mercy more than we remember anything else. He said, "She believed in me when everybody else disbelieved in me. She accepted me when everybody else rejected me. And she aided me with her wealth when nobody would give me a dinar. And she had all of my children while Allah denied that from any other woman. You are not better than her. I love you, But don't ever put yourself on the same level of this woman. She has a place with me that nobody else will have. That is the loyalty that comes as a result of these kind gestures that we extend to one another in our relationships. Brothers and sisters, honor the experiences that you have with your spouses, with your children. Every experience should be in addition to the bank account, the emotional bank accounts that we have with one another. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we learn to honor the experiences that we have with one another. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Oh Allah, we ask you for the good of this life and the good of the hereafter, and to save us from the hellfire. اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي فيها معادنا وجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير وجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم إنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. Oh Allah, we have wronged ourselves by committing sin and acts of disobedience. And if you do not forgive us and have mercy upon us, indeed we will be from amongst the losers. Oh, the merciful, oh, the most benevolent, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wa akhiru da'wana ala alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa aqimu s-salam.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la